Thanks for joining on a Saturday evening in the such humid atmosphere. I'm Nikhil Purohit. Last year, this program was organized as a humble activity of 3 evenings in the locale of Dombivli in collaboration with some of my friends Hansodne Tambe, Atish Shalke and Mayurish Sharaf and myself. This year, I shared this idea with Professor Sansod and Tambe sir, so, and he willingly agreed to take it up here and conduct it for all of us. So I express my gratitude towards Rajasthan Sansad and Camlin for being with us. Today about 2.5 lakh students have aptitude, are evaluated and for in Maharashtra are evaluated to have aspiration for the fine arts, which is higher than other streams of arts, science and commerce. While it is a sign of arts and creative industries gaining significance in the society, it is equally a matter of concern what exactly are the guiding pragmatism and ideologies behind it. Today's program intends to initiate a dialogue to prepare and implement the approach of learning through arts and culture locally and promote a balanced intellectual, emotional and psychological development of individuals and societies as observed by UNESCO's Art Education Program. The bilingual program in Marathi and English will discuss the crucial role of integrated arts education through a review of state of art education in the Art School of Maharashtra and Rajasthan by artist Madhavi Marathe and a paper presentation by visual analyst Nitin Arun Kulkarni on the role of experiencing in visual thinking, followed by a discussion conducted by artist pedagogue Mahendra Damle. Before we begin with the presentations, I take the pleasure of introducing our today's speakers. Of course, the audience members, most of us know who they are, but just as a formal introduction. Madhavi Marathe, born in Nagpur, is a senior artist who has contribution in the fields of classical Indian music as well as modern Indian art through literature as well as practice. Imarthe received his formal training in painting at the Sir J.J. School of Art, and he continued to paint objects in his rustic style, animating them. He was associated with Camlin as an expert. Being trained as a vocalist and with an MA degree in Indian, North Indian vocal classical music from Mumbai University, he later took to writing on music extensively for newspaper reviews, critical and educative columns. The music encyclopedia published by Vivek Publication is one of the important contributions. He currently lives and works in Thane. Nitin Arun Kulkarni, our second speaker, is a visual analyst, a poet and a design educator with an experience of 23 years in art and design practice. He has written several articles on art criticism, focusing on histories of art and contemporary art practices, including a column Chitra Shatak in Maharashtra Times in year 2000 and Design Diary in Lokmat last year, that's 2015. A collection of his poems was published in 1999 titled Pahila Kavita. He has designed curriculums on design thinking, visualization and representation, and introduction to world art and culture. His research subject has been cognition and visual and design visualization. Graduating from Sir J.J. School of Art, he completed his post-graduation by research in cognition and design visualization from University of Aurangabad. Currently, he lives and works in Navi Mumbai. Mahendra Damle is a painter, writer, educationist, working and developing pedagogical tools since past 20 years in visual arts education for a diverse audience, and has taught architecture, fashion and furniture design and animation. Art Thinking is a program designed by him for schools aiming to create integrated learning through art. Currently, he heads the Department of Fine Arts at Rajasthan Sansad, which we are here today, Mumbai, and has contributed as a columnist in Lok Satta titled Kalnya Se Drishya Varne, elaborating nuances of visual perceptions. I now invite Imarthi sir to begin with his presentation, and I request everybody to keep their mobile phones on silent mode, please. Thank you.
Hello. नमस्कार. काय माझं थोडं आज आवाज बसला आहे. खरं म्हटलं तर महाराष्ट्रातल्या कला शिक्षणाबद्दल बोलताना हा थोडा चढायला पाहिजे पण माझं खाली दिसत. ॲक्च्युली हा जो माझा सर्वे होता हा गोव्याच्या फाउंडेशन फॉर इंडियन आर्ट अँड एज्युकेशन या प्रकल्पाखाली आर्ट स्कूलचा महाराष्ट्रातल्या 20 आर्ट स्कूलमध्ये जाऊन प्रत्यक्ष पाहणी करून केलेलं हे सर्वेक्षण आहे. त्याचबरोबर राजस्थानमधल्या 10 कॉलेजमध्ये आर्ट कॉलेजमध्ये जाऊन केलेलं हे सर्वेक्षण आणि ते करताना ज्याला आपण फर्स्ट हँड इन्फॉर्मेशन म्हणतो की प्रत्यक्ष वस्तुस्थिती पाहून तिथे निरीक्षकून त्या ज्या नोंदी केल्या त्या नोंदी मी इथे सादर करणार आहे थोडक्यात. मी महाराष्ट्रात 200 वर आर्ट स्कूल आहे. आता त्या आर्ट स्कूलची परिस्थिती कशी आहे वगैरे या बोलण्यात काही अर्थ नाही. पण आज तुम्ही जे ऐकलं की अजूनही आर्टकडे लोकांचा ओढा वाढतो आहे त्यामुळे आर्ट स्कूल एस्टॅब्लिश होणं हे फार महत्त्वाचा घटक आहे. पण त्या कशा आहेत काय आहेत त्याचाही विचार होणं आवश्यक आहे. गोष्ट अशी आहे की विदर्भातल्या मी या 200 फक्त 20 स्कूलमध्ये गेलो त्यामुळे आपण म्हणू की काही एक प्रातिनिधिक स्कूल की ज्यात पेंटिंगचे कोर्स आहेत डिप्लोमा डिग्री वगैरे त्या तिथे त्यातूनच काही हे निरीक्षण आले आहेत. सर्वात या निरीक्षणामधूनच्या नोंदी आल्या त्या या हा जो सर्वे होता या सर्वेची रूपरेखा अशी होती की यात काही प्रश्नावली दिली होती आणि ती प्रश्नावली त्या प्रश्नावली साधारणपणे तिथे कुठले कुठले कोर्स चालतात तिथे कुठल्या कुठल्या आर्ट ॲक्टिव्हिटीज होतात त्यांची लायब्ररी कशी आहे त्याचप्रमाणे कुठले वर्कशॉप तिथे होतात आणि एकंदर जी काही म्हणजे शैक्षणिक आपण स्थिती म्हणून त्या स्कूलची त्याबद्दलचं एक डॉक्युमेंटेशन तयार करणं असं होतं. अर्थात ते झालं ते डॉक्युमेंटेशन पण त्यावरती जे मला प्रत्यक्षात अनुभव आलं त्या अनुभवाबद्दल मी आज बोलणार. पहिला महत्त्वाचा भाग आहे की या ज्या बऱ्याचशा म्हणजे मुंबई पुणे नागपूर सोडून विदर्भातले किंवा मराठवाड्यातले ज्या काही कला संस्था किंवा कला विद्यालय आहेत त्या काही संस्था चालवतात आणि या संस्थाचं पाठबळ त्यांना विशेष करून नसल्यामुळे त्यात बऱ्याच अडचणी येतात. त्यामुळे विद्यार्थ्यांना सोयी सुविधा ज्या पुरवल्या पाहिजे त्या पुरवल्या इथे जात नाही. त्यामुळे विद्यार्थ्यांना समजा आपण म्हटलं की वर्गातलं फर्निचर ते देखील पुरेसं नसतं असा अनुभव आहे. दुसरी गोष्ट अशी आहे की बहुतेक विद्यार्थी जे आहेत हे ग्रामीण भागातून आलेले आहेत. बऱ्याच ठिकाणी नागपूर मुंबई पुणे हे सोडून आणि त्या विद्यार्थ्यांना या एकंदर पेंटिंगच्या अभ्यासक्रमाबद्दल कुठलीही माहिती नसते ना त्यांना ना त्यांच्या पालकांना. साधारण असं होतं की ज्यांच्याजवळ उज्जत गुण आहे ते चित्रकला शिकायला तिकडे येतात पण ज्यांच्याजवळ उत्सद गुण नाही आहे पण ज्यांना कुठेही ॲडमिशन मिळाली नाही ते देखील यात भरती होतात. आणि त्यांचा असा एक समज असतो की हा जो कोर्स आहे पेंटिंगचा या पेंटिंगचा कोर्स झाल्यावर आपल्याला कुठेतरी डिग्री कुठेतरी नोकरी मिळेल. मुळात हे जे अभ्यासक्रम असतात म्हणजे कलाविषयक अभ्यासक्रम हे जॉब ओरिएंटेड नसतात. म्हणजे लगेच तुम्ही केलं की तुम्हाला लगेच जॉब मिळेल असं नसतं. म्हणजे जसे बाकीचे इंजिनियर मेडिकल कॉलेजमध्ये सांगतात की आमच्या इथे पास झाल्याबरोबर तुम्हाला दुसरीकडे जॉब मिळेल, असं इथे काही नसतं. तर इथे इथे काय असतं की तुमच्या विद्यार्थ्यांमधल्या उज्ज्वल गुणाला, सृजनशक्तीला वाव देणं, त्यांचं पर्सेप्शन वाढवणं, त्यांच्या सेन्सिटिव्हिटीज काय जाणून येणं, त्याचबरोबर जे काही दृश्यकलेच्या अंगाने आविष्कार होतात त्याची तंत्र त्यांना समजावून देणं, आणि स्वतंत्र, आपण ज्याला स्वतंत्र म्हणतो, असं स्वतःचं व्यक्तिमत्व शोधणं असा त्याचा एक भाग असतो. पण हे आपल्याकडे होत नाही, त्यामुळे विद्यार्थ्यांचा भ्रमनिरास होतो, आणि मग विद्यार्थ्यांचं शिक्षणाला इंटरेस्ट पण गेलेला दिसतो. त्यांना असं वाटतं की आपण शिकल्याबरोबर एक तर चित्रकार व्हावं, शिकल्याबरोबर चित्रकार होत नाही हे सगळ्यांनाच माहीत आहे. दुसरी गोष्ट नाही तर आपल्याला जॉब लागला. पण हा एक दोष आपल्याला ग्रामीण विभागात दिसून, दुसरा भाग असा आपल्या कला शिक्षणातल्या ज्या मर्यादा आहेत, जे अकॅडमिक ट्रेनिंग आहे, तो अकॅडमिक ट्रेनिंग आणि सध्या बाहेर चाललेली कला यात भेद आहे. त्याचा आणि याचा काहीही संबंध नाही. कला शिक्षण हे बरंच म्हणजे जवळजवळ 30-35 वर्षापासून अजूनही आर्ट स्कूलमधली शिक्षण पद्धती किंवा सिलॅबस बदललं नाही, आणि 90 तर हे बाहेर जे आविष्कार चालू आहेत आज नव्या माध्यमामध्ये, ते एवढ्या सपाट्याने जात आहेत की विद्यार्थ्यांना त्याच्याविषयी कुणकुण असते, त्यांना काहीतरी अंधुकसं माहीत असतं, पण त्यांना स्पष्ट जाणीव नसते की हे नेमकं काय चालू आहे. आणि मुख्य म्हणजे ती जाणीव देण्याची कुठलीही यंत्रणा आपल्याकडे नाही. आता मी जेव्हा यंत्रणा म्हणतो अर्थात त्याच्यात शिक्षक आलेच, त्याच्यामुळे आजचे शिक्षक देखील याला थोडे बहुत जबाबदार आहे असं मी म्हणू शकतो. त्याचं कारण की आजच्या विषयीचं, आजच्या कलेविषयीचं भान त्यांना अजिबात नाही. आणि यांनी काय होतं की नेमकी कला म्हणजे काय, आज काय चालू आहे, आपण हे कशा करता करतोय, आपण हा कोर्स करून आपल्याला काय मिळणार, याचं भान विद्यार्थ्याला नसतं, ही एक समज येऊ शकते. की निश्चित व्यवसायाची कला आणि स्व अभिव्यक्तीची कला यातला जो भेद आहे, हा भेद त्यांना समजू शकतो, एवढं होऊ शकतो. त्याकरता आपल्याला शिक्षकांना पुन्हा ट्रेन करण्याची काही जरुरी आहे. म्हणजे आपण ज्याला रिफ्रेशर कोर्स म्हणतो असा, पण तो आपल्याकडे राबवला जात नाही अशी परिस्थिती आहे. त्यामुळे जे काय होतं ते होऊ दे, आणि विद्यार्थी हा थोडासा गोंधळात सापडला, त्याच्यामुळे मी काय करू, म्हणजे बाहेर तर हे चालतं, आणि प्रत्यक्ष कोर्समध्ये काय होतं तर अजूनही आम्ही पोर्ट्रेट आणि लँडस्केप महाराष्ट्राविषयी बोलायचं तर याच्या पलीकडे जाऊ शकलो नाही. म्हणजे पोर्ट्रेट वाईट आहे का, पोर्ट्रेट वाईट नाही, चांगलं, अगदी बिलकुल 1880 हा व्यवसायाकरता विषय निवडलेले विषय आहे असं सांगितलं आहे. आताही लोक बऱ्याचशा कॉलेजमध्ये पण पुढचा व्यवसाय आपल्याला मिळेल म्हणूनच पोर्ट्रेट घेतात. पण परिस्थिती अशी आहे की आता याविषयी नवे दृष्टिकोन देण्याची जरूर आली आहे, पण अजूनही आम्ही त्या चाकोरीबद्ध एका अकॅडमिक, आपण ज्याला म्हणू शब्द बरोबर नाही आहे कारण अकॅडमिकचा शब्द वेगळा असतो, तरी पण यात एवढे अडकलो आहे की आम्ही तेच ते पुन्हा करतो. आणि आजकाल सवयीचे पोर्ट्रेट काढतो. जेव्हा महाराष्ट्राच्या आर्ट स्कूलमध्ये मी गेलो तेव्हा मला असं वाटलं की सर्वीकडे तेच पोर्ट्रेट, सर आम्ही काय घेणार, पोर्ट्रेट, दुसरा पर्याय नाही. कारण पोर्ट्रेटला आम्हाला दुसरे विषय पण त्यांना नाही, कंपोजिशन ग्राफिक वगैरे जे आहेत त्याविषयी पण त्यांचं मत नाही. पोर्ट्रेट कशाला, तर पोर्ट्रेटमुळे आम्हाला काहीतरी मिळेल. आजकाल परिस्थिती अशी आहे की पोर्ट्रेट पण फारसे केल्या जात नाही आणि त्याचा दर्जा वगैरे याविषयी बोलणं चालू. पण आज जे होत आहे की आर्ट स्कूलमध्ये पोर्ट्रेट किंवा लँडस्केप हा जो भाग आहे हा आपण ज्याला म्हणतो जरा यांत्रिक पद्धतीने होतो आहे. काहीतरी एक तंत्र कुठेतरी शिक्षक सांगतो, त्या तंत्राचं तो तंत्र फॉलो करतात आणि मग तशाच पद्धतीचे अनेक पोर्ट्रेट होत असतात. कोणीतरी येतो, मग डेमॉन्स्ट्रेशन आपल्याकडे होतं, डेमॉन्स्ट्रेशन देतो, तो 2 तासात झटपट छान पोर्ट्रेट करतो आणि मुलांना वाटतं की हेच पोर्ट्रेट हेच. आणि याविषयी त्यांचे गैरसमज होतात. म्हणजे खरं म्हटलं तर पोर्ट्रेट किंवा ह्युमन स्टडी हा एका चांगल्या पद्धतीने विचार केला आणि या आजच्या आजच्या 90च्या काळानंतर तर त्याचे आविष्कार वेगळ्या वेगळ्या पद्धतीने होऊ शकतात, त्याची जाण देणं आवश्यक आहे. असा भाग लँडस्केपचा पण आहे. लँडस्केप आम्ही काय करतो, आम्हीच इमिटेट केलेलं पुन्हा इमिटेट करतो. म्हणजे प्रत्यक्ष निसर्ग पाहत नाही तर कोणीतरी केलेलं लँडस्केप आमच्या डोळ्यासमोर असतात. कुणीतरी रंग असे असे असतात, असे झाडं असतात, तसे झाडं असतात. आम्ही स्पॉट शोधतो कुठला तो चांगला दिसणार आणि मग आम्ही लँडस्केप करतो. तेच लँडस्केप म्हणजे तिथे रंग कसाही असो, तिथे निसर्ग अस्ताव्यस्त असो, पण आम्ही त्याला एक छान फ्रेम देतो आणि आम्ही म्हणतो की लँडस्केप म्हणजे हा एक रोमॅन्टिसिझम आहे. तो चांगला आहे. पिकनिकला गेल्यासारखं जात मुलं जातात आणि लँडस्केप करतात काही हरकत. पण मग आता वेळ आहे की या लँडस्केपमधून पालपीसारख्या लोकांनी पण म्हणजे निसर्गातून स्फूर्ती घेऊन बऱ्याच गोष्टी केल्या. मग आता वेळ आहे की या सगळ्या गोष्टी सोडून आपण काही वेगळं करू शकतो का. यात मला अजून एक राजस्थानबद्दल सांगायचं. म्हणजे राजस्थानमध्ये मी जेव्हा गेलो, तेव्हा थोडीशी विरुद्ध परिस्थिती आहे. मला सांगायला आनंद होतो की राजस्थानपेक्षा महाराष्ट्राची परिस्थिती फार चांगली आहे. विशेषतः मानव आकृतीचा जो अभ्यास मुंबई आणि महाराष्ट्रामध्ये आहे तो तिकडे अजिबात नाही. तिकडे लोक कंपोजिशन घेतात का, तर रिअलिस्टिक हा जो भाग आहे हा फार कठीण आहे. तुम्हीच कशाला त्या भांगडी करता, म्हणून सगळेजण रिअलिस्टिकला किंवा या ह्युमन फिगरला टाळतात असा तिथला एक होईल. त्यामुळे महाराष्ट्रातली ह्युमन फिगर आणि पोर्ट्रेट ह्याचा दर्जा चांगलाच आहे. फक्त महाराष्ट्र तंत्रात अडकला आहे आणि त्या तंत्रातून बाहेर आलं तर कदाचित यातून वेगवेगळे आविष्कार चांगल्या पद्धतीने महाराष्ट्रात होऊ शकतील. पण त्याला जी गरज आहे ती काही वेगळ्या गोष्टीची आहे. एक तर शिक्षकांमध्ये, मला असं वाटतं की शिक्षकांमध्ये अपडेट, शिक्षकांना अपडेट होण्याची गरज आहे. आज की जे जे काही चालू आहे बाहेर, म्हणजे आपण म्हणू की साईट्स पेकेशन, साईट्स व्हिडिओ आला किंवा इन्स्टॉलेशन किंवा या ज्या गोष्टी आहेत मला, तर याची जाणीवपूर्वक विद्यार्थ्यांना कल्पना देणं आवश्यक आहे. त्यामुळे त्यांना आपण कुठे आहोत कळेल आणि आपल्याला नेमकं काय करायचं कळेल. त्याचबरोबर त्यांचा जो समज आहे की या या गोष्टीबद्दल, ते इन्स्टॉलेशन वगैरे मला बऱ्याच जणांनी सांगितलं की आम्ही इन्स्टॉलेशन वगैरे करतो, म्हणजे सोशलला वगैरे असं वगैरे काहीतरी करतात. मग ते काहीतरी चैत्र वगैरे मांडण्यासारखे मा करतात, काहीतरी इकडून मांडायचं, इकडून घ्यायचं, इकडून त्यायचं, ते इन्स्टॉलेशन. किंवा मग सगळ्यात विषय कुठला आजचा, आता पर्यावरण ना, पर्यावरण हे असे काही विषय आहेत की जे लोकं घेतात आणि मग आम्ही इन्स्टॉलेशन करतो असंही म्हणतात. त्यामुळे त्या विषयाची विद्यार्थ्यांना जाण देणं अत्यंत आवश्यक आहे. त्यामुळे एकतर ते हे करो न करो, पण आपण काय करतो आहे हे त्यांना निश्चित समजू. दुसरा एक मोठा प्रश्न आहे आपल्याकडे वाचन. म्हणजे निर्णयाच्यात गेल्यावर मी बऱ्याच जणांना तुम्हाला कुठले कुठले आर्टिस्ट माहीत आहे असं विचार, फक्त 4 नावं आली माझ्यासमोर. पिकासो, म्हणजे रवी वर्मा, हुसेन आणि तिसरा व्हॅनगो, चौथा व्हॅनगो. बाकी लोकल आर्टिस्ट, एखाद दोन लोकल आर्टिस्ट, फारच झालं तर बर्वेंचं मराठी, फारच झालं तर हां ते पण त्यांना सांगावं. त्यामुळे त्यांचं वाचन हे किती मर्यादेचं. बरं, लायब्ररीत कोणीही जात नाही. लायब्ररी काही ठिकाणी भरल्या तर काही ठिकाणी एखाद दोन कपाट आहेत, त्यांना ते लायब्ररी म्हणतात. मुख्य म्हणजे कुठल्याही प्रकारची पुस्तकं तिथे अपडेट केला जात नाही. लायब्ररीमध्ये जात नाही याचे दोन कारण आहेत. एक तर इंग्लिश भाषेचा प्रश्न आहे, तो साहजिक आहे की इंग्लिशमधून वाचणं त्यांना जमत नाही, त्यामुळे जमत नाही किंवा त्यांना समजत नाही, त्यामुळे ते लायब्ररी जात नाही. आता ही जबाबदारी पुन्हा कला इतिहास जे लोक शिकवतात आणि सौंदर्यशास्त्र जे लोक शिकवतात त्यांची पण आहे. त्यांना त्याविषयीची उत्सुकता वाटणं असं शिकवणं हे महत्त्वाचं आहे. होतं काय की त्यांना कला इतिहास त्यांच्याच वर्गातले गुरुजी शिकवतात. आता कला इतिहास आपले तज्ज्ञ आणि सौंदर्यशास्त्रातले तज्ज्ञ हे ज्या पद्धतीने शिकवतात त्या पद्धतीने हे शिकवू शकत नाही. मुळात शिकवायला काय पाहिजे की कला इतिहासातल्या संकल्पना आविष्कार शैली यांची त्यांना माहिती द्यायला पाहिजे की जेणेकरून ते जे काम करतात त्या कामाचा आणि कला इतिहासाचा काही संबंध आहे का हे त्यांना कळलं पाहिजे. तसंच सौंदर्यशास्त्र सौंदर्यशास्त्र म्हणजे वाचन नाही म्हणजे कसं. आता हे जर त्यांना कळलं तर त्यांची गोडी वाचनात जास्त होईल. सौंदर्यशास्त्राबद्दल पण असंच आहे. सुंदर आणि सौंदर्य या कल्पना आहेत, या कल्पना त्यांच्यापर्यंत पोचत नाही. खरं म्हटलं तर सौंदर्यशास्त्रात मराठी पुस्तकं बरीच आहे, नाही असं नाही. कॉन्टेम्पररी इंडियन आर्ट फॉर मराठी पुस्तकं नाही, जास्ती नाही, ती गरज आहे. आणि आपल्या इथलं डायरेक्टरेट असा काही एक हे घेत नाही की बाबा मराठीत विद्यार्थ्यांना उपलब्ध चांगली पुस्तकं असेल हे असा प्रयत्न करत. सौंदर्यशास्त्रात जर समजा विचारलं की माधव वाचवर, द ग गोडसे, रावा पाटणकर, बासी मर्डेकर इतके बरेच लोकांनी सौंदर्य प्रभाकर पाध्ये बऱ्याच लोकांनी सौंदर्यशास्त्र पण त्यांना आम्ही हात लावत नाही. एक असं आहे की चित्रकलेविषयी सौंदर्य दृष्टिकोन असं पुस्तक मात्र इकडे आलं नाही अजून चांगल्या पद्धतीने आलं की नाही मला माहीत नाही. पण चांगल्या पद्धतीने आलं की नाही याविषयी मी फारसा हे नाही, बहुतेक आलं पण असेल पण माझ्या वाचनात अजून आलं नाही. एक इनामदारांचं पुस्तक आलं आहे इकडचं पण ते पाश्चात्य कलेविषयी जास्ती आहे, कॉन्टेम्पररी आणि आजच्या कलेविषयी नाही. तर अशा प्रकारे कला इतिहास आणि सौंदर्यशास्त्र याचा अभ्यास विद्यार्थ्यांना हे दोन्ही विषय प्रिय वाटतील असं करणं आवश्यक आहे आणि ते तसं होत नाही. त्यामुळे मला असं वाटतं की या काही गोष्टी अत्यंत जरुरीच्या आहेत. कला इतिहास सौंदर्यशास्त्र त्याचबद्दल त्यांना याविषयीची वाटणारी गोडी आणि आजच्या आधुनिक आजची जी कला आहे त्याविषयीची त्यांची जाण त्यांना देणं आवश्यक. शिक्षणात त्याचा समावेश करणं, त्यांनी करो न करो पण शिक्षणात त्यांचा समावेश करणं हे महत्त्वाचं. बाकीचे मुद्दे असे आहेत की आज संगणक स्मार्टफोन सर्वीकडे दिसतात. ही जी तांत्रिक प्रगती आहे याचा उपयोग आम्ही का नाही करावा की करावा. फक्त हाताने केलेलीच कला ही चांगली असते का हा महत्त्वाचा प्रश्न. आज संगणकांनी देखील काही गोष्टी होऊ शकतात चांगल्या, तुम्ही तुमच्या पलीकडे जाऊ शकता त्याचाही उपयोग करायला हरकत. किंवा बऱ्याचदा मला तक्रार आली आहे की आमचे विद्यार्थी काय आहे की मॉडेलचा फोन हे करतात, स्मार्टफोननी फोटो काढतात आणि घरी जाऊन पेंटिंग करतात. त्याच्यात काहीच हरकत नाही खरं म्हटलं तर, समोर बसून करण्यापेक्षा ते घरी करतात. पण फक्त एक गोष्ट अशी आहे की त्यांना जाण देण्याची कल्पना अशी आहे की तुम्ही फोटोवरून केल्यावर काय होतं आणि प्रत्यक्ष पाहून केल्यावर काय होतं त्यातला भेद त्यांना स्पष्ट करणं आवश्यक. याच्यावर टीका करून काही उपयोगाची नाही. त्यामुळे आज जी काही तांत्रिक सुलभता आपण ज्याला म्हणू त्याचा उपयोग घेणं आणि त्या गोष्टी आपल्या अभ्यासक्रमात शक्यतो ॲड करणं हे महत्त्वाचं आहे असं मला वाटतं. नाही तर हा जो कोर्स चालू झाला कोर्स आहे आपला सध्या त्याच पद्धतीने लोक पेंटिंग करत असतील तर मग मला असं वाटतं की कला शिक्षण इथलं पुढे जाईल की नाही याबद्दल शंका आहे. काय ग्रामीण विद्यार्थी बऱ्याच ठिकाणी असल्यामुळे त्यांना प्रदर्शनाला वगैरे जात नाही. तर काही ठिकाणी मी पाहिलं की शिक्षक दिल्लीला वगैरे जाऊन व्हिडिओ शूटिंग करतात एक्झिबिशनचं आणि त्यांना दाखवतात, म्हणजे त्यांच्यापर्यंत काही काही गोष्टी पोचतात निश्चितच पण त्यांना त्यांची समज देणं हे होत नाही. त्यामुळे आज त्यांना माहीत आहे. आज तुम्ही असं नका समजू की विद्यार्थ्यांना काही माहीत नाही, त्यांना कुठे कुठे काय चालतं हे माहीत आहे, आणि त्यांना असंही वाटतं की आपण काहीतरी करावं. आणि याचा अनुभव जे पटवर्धनांनी जे एक्झिबिशन केलं होतं त्यात आहे की बरेचसे, मला त्याचं नाव एकदम आठवत नाही, पण त्यात बरेचसे उत्सुक विद्यार्थी, कला विद्यार्थी, चित्रकार देखील ते प्रदर्शन पाहायला उत्सुक होते आणि चर्चा करायला, चर्चा ऐकायला उत्सुक होते. त्यामुळे याच्यावरून आपल्याला असं दिसतं की या नव्या अभिव्यक्तीबद्दल विद्यार्थ्यांना, कला विद्यार्थ्यांना बरीच आत्मीयता आहे. फक्त त्यांच्यापर्यंत ते चांगल्या रीतीने आणि सकारात्मक दृष्ट्या पोहोचणं आवश्यक आहे. मला असं वाटत की इतकं बस झालं आता. मला जे काही महत्वाचे मुद्दे सांगितले, मुद्दे सांगायचे होते ते मी इथे सांगितले. याच्यानंतर जर तुम्हाला काही प्रश्न असतील तर मग नंतर आपण विचारू. धन्यवाद.
गुड इव्हनिंग टू ऑल प्रेझेंट हियर. And firstly, I would like to thank Rachana Sansa, especially Mahendra Damle, to organize this particular event and called me to express my thoughts, which is, these thoughts have been formulated in my experience of teaching over the period of around 20 years. So I think now the time has come that I should start expressing myself and start interacting with you all to make this particular thought more applicable in a very positive sense. Although there's going to be a lot of criticism in my talk today, but the criticism is not aimed at saying that whatever is happening is bad or it's not happening in the right spirit. But wherever we have to say, we have to say. We have to understand limitations and we try to do something in order to overcome these difficulties. So basically my area is role of experiencing in visual thinking, which I have been working on visual thinking in design basically. So my presentation is consists of two parts. One, the paper which I have written, I will read that paper, and then I have a small presentation, PPT presentation, visual presentation, through which it will open up for discussion at a later stage. So if you want, you can also ask questions on the paper which I am going to read. Before I begin, I would like to state that our focus of discussion today is art education, rather than art itself. There is a need to reiterate this, since the focus of art education has been on giving instruction which help creating work of art, hence revolves around art. Techniques of visual representation is emphasized in great detail rather than creating discourse on process of art creation. I propose the approach of visual thinking as part of experiential learning rather than mimesis-driven art practice in art education. It is imperative to take such a holistic view by all the stakeholders of art education today. Therefore, there is a need to look at art education as an independent entity which creates a body of work which deals with consolidation of contemporary sensibilities and nurture them in order to serve the society in various capacities, and not only art field should be its recipient. This will be possible when we consider art education as experience education. problem of art object being the destination of art experience. In common conception, the work of art is often identified with any object in reality, like building, book, painting or statue. As John Dewey states it, the very perfection of some of these products, and also because of the prestige they possess and its long history of unquestioned admiration, create conventions that get in the way of fresh insights. The artworks become isolated from the human conditions under which it was brought into being and from the human consequences it engenders in actual life experiences. The artwork is still valued in the domain of art education because of its tangible nature, and poor practice of documentation of art practice of an individual which might have responsible to give him many ideas. This also brings recognition and monetary value in future also becomes a driving force. Conventional wisdom of this nature is formulated in a vacuum which pervades with the regional as well as global concerns of art practice. The isolation of art experience from life experience. अनुभवातल्या सगळ्या गोष्टी दिसतातच असं नाही आणि सगळ्या दिसलेल्या गोष्टींचा अनुभव आलेला असेलच असं नाही आणि त्याचमुळे चित्रकलेसाठी वेगळ्या प्रकारच्या अनुभवाची गरज भासते. मला असं वाटतं की इथेच फसगत होते. चित्र काढण्यासाठी घेण्याचा अनुभव आणि एकंदर जीवनातला अनुभव यामध्ये आपण फरक करत जातो. दुसऱ्या बाजूला आपल्या मनात कलेचे शिक्षण व सांस्कृतिकतेतून सौंदर्य निर्मिती व कला या जोडगोळीची खुणगाड बसलेली असते. नित्याच्या जगण्यात सौंदर्यानुभूती ही अनुभव आणि दृश्य यांच्यामध्ये येते, अडसर ठरते. आणि आपल्याला वेळोवेळी हेही लक्षात आलेलं असतं की प्रत्येक अनुभवामध्ये स्वतःसाठी सौंदर्यानुभूती नाही, तरीही काही अनुभव आपल्याला खिळवून ठेवतात किंवा त्या क्षणी आपण दिग्मूढ होऊन गेलेलो असतो. आणि चित्रकार या नात्याने चित्रात रूपांतरित करण्यासारखं आपल्याला काहीही सापडलेलं नसतं. कधी कधी तर अशा अनुभवात दृश्यात्मक काही नसतं देखील. त्यामुळे साहजिकच असं होतं की असे बरेचसे अनुभव आपण दुर्लक्षित करण्याची शक्यता असते. यातून आपल्याला गम्य अशा अनुभवांशी संलग्न राहण्याची शक्यता राहते. म्हणजे अनुभवांची चित्रनिर्मिती व चित्रनिर्मितीसाठीचा अनुभव अशासारखं विशेष सर्कल तयार होतं. कला शिक्षणात याच प्रक्रियेला सबल केलं जातं. याला काही शह देता येईल का? म्हणजे द्यायची गरज आहे असं आपल्याला वाटतं का? माझा अनुभव सांगतो की क्रिएटिव्ह प्रोसेसमध्ये असलेल्या बऱ्याच जणांना असं वाटत असतं की काहीतरी वेगळेपणा आला पाहिजे. कारण तोचतोपणा वर नमूद केलेल्या कारणांमुळे असतो आणि आपलाच आपल्याला कंटाळा आलेला असतो. एकीकडे तोचतोपणाचा आपल्याला फायदाही होत असतो. आपली स्टाईल, आपली ओळख, जातकुळी ही त्यातूनच ठरत असते. परंतु त्याबरोबरीनेच आपल्याला काहीतरी वेगळं जाणवत असतं. आपली वाढ होते आणि त्या वाढीनुसार आपल्या जाणीवांमध्ये बदल होतोय असंही वाटत असतं. हे जर आपल्याला पटलं असेल तर एकंदरीत अनुभव घेण्याची एक गुणात्मक संकल्पना आहे, त्याकडे यावं लागतं. इथे जय कृष्णमूर्ती आपल्याला मदत करतात. एक्सपिरियन्सिंग द एक्सपिरियन्स. यू सी अ डॉग अँड इन्स्टंटली थॉट टर्न्स to whatever image you may have about dogs, so you never see a dog. J. Krishnamurti. The mundane seeing never progresses as seeing. It culminates into an image, and this image is derived from memory. According to Krishnamurti, thinking implies a continuous memory. Hence, this kind of seeing is thinking. On the other hand, if we consider the step earlier, which is about the sensory perception, according to Jay Krishnamurti, perception is not the activity of thought. It is insight into the whole nature of movement of the world, the symbol, the image, and their emotional involvement. Image is created in the mind, and the mind is preoccupied with meaning and thought. Therefore, thought prevents perception. Can we apply this process to visual art and see if it gives us a fresh premise? Representation of the mental image creates thought in conformity. Visual conformity idealizes and validates the new as already known, known as known. Whereas the non-conformist approach leads us to make the known less known, with all its nuances towards the process of perception. Is the artist liberated from the known in true sense? In art education, a lot of emphasis has been given on depiction of the experience and or creating a new experience through making of an artwork rather than experience itself. Emphasis is laid on the technique of representation and creating a stunning visual. This creates an overlay on the artist's experience of reality. In fact, art education and its pedagogy tries to propagate this. The aspect of experiencing of the real without having preconcept is overshadowed. As said by Jay Krishnamurti, experiencing is different than experience. Experience is of the past and activated through memory. Experiencing is the aspect of present with a strong sense of deactivating the past, taking into account the freshness of any subject. Of experiencing, it depends on its setup and mainly our own positioning. The quality of sense depend on this. A school of thought which still pervades don't believe in the deliberative practice to consciously making change into the quality of experience itself. The very basic process of seeing involves the role of memory. Is it really possible to make the memory inactive? Creating actual memory loss is not possible. But ignoring it psychologically is possible. It will be something like having virtual Alzheimer's disease. Here we can take help of meditative technology, which we can call it Dhyana Pranit Anubhav Pranali. So this is the end of my paper, and I will go now for the small PPT. PPT I made not because I am habitual to make PPTs, but because words sometimes are impossible to, we cannot comprehend. So certain visual examples along with certain theories, because it is not that what I have written here, I have completely discovered myself. There are theories and there are people who have thought on similar direction. So, can we take a survey of whatever theories or whatever thoughts are available to us, which we can consolidate and we can use it for our own methodologies? Did I ask you? Before could I ask you, you have the answer. And you don't just have the answer, but you have gone beyond this and started describing the substance presented in the visual. Further, sorry, the image is not that clear, but all of us might have seen this image earlier also. So this drawing of dog at rest by Albert Durer portrays a very personal image. He has drawn the fur with the focus on softness and has executed precise rendering of the dog's features. The viewer can see that he has a great affinity to animals, that he wants to show them as precious and esteemed creatures, which he has a great compassion for. Now, this could be a merely an interpretation of the critic who have written about this particular drawing. But as we have seen, there were two images, the first image of the dog and the second image of the dog, we definitely can say that Albert Durer's image was not merely a representation of dog. It had certain qualities which were associated with it. We can argue whether the way it is mentioned here, those were the same qualities or no, but we will have a similar opinion about the kind of qualities which were present in that image of dog. So the premise here is that representation is just a tool in art education. I think this is somewhere missed out when the practice of mimesis starts from the day one, that a certain shape is drawn on the board and you're supposed to imitate that shape in your drawing book. This first step of conceiving art in the student's mind deals with visual representation alone. I'm not saying that from the day one he should be taught conceptual understanding or moving him towards developing new concepts with which he can only create certain kind of art which can be called as abstract. I'm not at all pointing out towards that. But what I'm trying to point out here is that representation is just a tool. This needs to be told to the teachers as well as students, and your entire methodology should follow this particular principle. Pause, because I take a lot of pauses because I want you to see something, and while you are seeing something, you are also thinking about something, so that thinking is important for me. So it is not that only I am thinking currently, you are also thinking, and only thing, you are not expressing your thoughts, which you will start expressing when the Nikhil will open for open discussion. So sorry for that pause. So suppose a new creature has been shown to you. absolutely a new creature, which you haven't seen before, some imaginary creature. Then the process will be slightly different as compared to the process which happened initially. All of you immediately, without even, I did not say anything, but you, your mind was telling you constantly that it's a dog and it's a Labrador dog. And you also were trying to figure out whether the dog is female or male or what not. So many other visualizations started happening in your mind. But here you might get confused. I'm just choosing random images. These images have taken from internet, and I'm taking these images to make my point clear to you. So here, that process will be slightly difficult because your brain is not giving you ready answers, but your brain will still give you some answers. Looks like hair, the mouth looks like a dog, a particular species of the dog, and this is a photoshopped image. Even your mind will tell you this is a photoshop, definitely. You will still refuse to see what is shown to you, but you will start seeing something which you want to see. This is the focus. I think this is the most important area which you should focus on. What is happening currently in your mind? And can we document what is happening in your mind? And can this documentation be treated as an exercise of drawing rather than just the exercise of thinking? Because thinking is not different than drawing. Robert Mackin says that for an artist, drawing is like a thinking. But the way we take that principle and we start applying it, that 100 sketches every day. Because drawing is thinking. The way we interpret these principles, I think there is some problem there. If we are trying to see an image with a fresh insight, can that insight be documented? And the documentation can happen with words, photography. There are so many mediums, as Sir was saying, Imarte Sir was saying, that people are now having gadgets. I am of the opinion, I tell my students, bring mobile camera in the class. Take the picture of your still life from 50 angles, which they are not doing. They are taking photograph only from 2 angles and they are happy with those 2 angles. I say, do something like David Hockney. I show them Hockney, so they are inspired. Okay, how Hockney went there and took 1,000 pictures and then he chose few hundreds out of that and then he made a collage and that became a work of art. Okay, we have to give them certain kind of carrots. These are the carrots. Okay, David Hockney was a carrot, which I showed them. But my main intention was to tell them, where does your technology is limited? Where exactly your technology is limited? And where your own perception starts? Whether your perception starts or it doesn't start. The way you look at that image, which is there in your mobile phone, that is also perception. It's not that looking at real object is only perception and looking at representation is not perception. So, in fact, I have started now encouraging rather than discouraging students taking pictures in the class. Okay. So basically, I wanted to give an example of that. So what is experience? Basically, the actual living through an event. Being there is experience. And basically, the sum of total of conscious events which compose an individual's life. It's very, very important that this is my individual life. It is, although it has certain universal feature, but it is an individual's perception. And this is about knowable reality. It is about knowable reality that is very important to state. Because from day one, there are these concepts of dream imagery and whatnot, that imagination is a word which is interpreted in a very great way and misunderstood most of the time, that I have to see something else in the present image. And I have to call that image something else. So, Lacanian thinking speaks of three realms, which is real, imaginary, and symbolic. So basically, there is a distinction which is made here, experiencing and experience. Even science make this distinction, not only Krishnamurti, but science also is defining experience differently from experiencing. So what is the real? The most difficult to grasp and define, an absence of sharp delineation between self and the world. We don't know what is happening. Where my individuality begins and where the world starts. The imaginary, which refers to direct correspondence between an object and its image. So I still don't know what is the significance. Although the world has given me a lot of images, so I start interpreting with those images. But as a, in principle, these three processes are important. The symbolic, the realm of assured and served by the introduction of signifiers. So there are signs. The moment you start seeing these, all these objects become signs, like language, and you start interpreting what you're seeing right from the, that point onwards. So that's what is happening in post-Lacanian thinking, that basically it goes on a semiotic level. So signification is one of the important processes which is described by these semioticians, which talks about how anything in the world is read by your mind and interpreted by your mind, and it creates certain kind of notions and it gives you certain kind of knowledge about the world. So basically, the meaning, ultimately a certain meaning is created or whatever you are experiencing. So signification process is very simple, which is signifier and signified. And basically, this particular theory comes from linguistics. So this theory might be limited in certain ways when we are applying it to the visual arts. But as far as the way Krishnamurti says that any image is getting formed in your mind, this methodology can be used there to just know what is happening currently with me. The moment the teacher has brought an object, before looking at that object, we have interpreted that object immediately. So what happened there? So here semiotics can help us to analyze my own process of perception and how I take that perception towards certain interpretation before I start seeing naturally the way that object appears. So one example here was that signifier is the word open, and signified concept that the shop is open for the business. So when the sign is there on the shop of open, that signifies that the shop is open. Okay. So this is a threefold model which is more apt, and most of the times when we are using it, we use this particular model very very often, because this is more accurate as I feel, which has sense, referent, and sign vehicle. Sorry, sign vehicle, sense, and referent. These three components. So there's a firstness, there's a secondness, and thirdness in the way I look at that particular sign. So sign vehicle, which is the form of the sign, sense, which is the sense made out of the sign, and referent, which is what the sign stands for. For example, when you're looking at this particular image, the sign vehicle is the photograph of that old lady kissing the calf. The sense is which is the sense made of the sign. What exactly is it makes the sense that she is very affectionate to the calf. Apparently it looks like cow also to us. And referent is what it stands for. So immediately external image, external element has been added here in this context. The world has been added here, and you say that this stands for India, the love for cow, it stands for that. Or you can have any other referent also, the way you are interpreting this particular image, but most often in my class, this was the referent very predominantly used by so many students. So this particular image is read in a particular way. So through this process of experiencing towards formation of experience, the image is bound to be created in mind, and the image bring world along with it. So what I mean to say is that if it is the word is predominant in entire process, first of all, let us illustrate that, let us understand that as a basic process of perception. Then let us come to the very primary process of sensation and perception, and all of us know that it has two different parts. One is sensory experience, and the other is the interpretation done by the brain of that sensory experience. As all of us know that there are this first process and second process, and perception depends on complex functions of the nervous system, but subjectively seems mostly effortless because of the processing happens outside conscious awareness. Before even we start thinking, immediately we got this idea that this is dog. It came to us so naturally when I showed those images of dog to you. So it is very automatic, and a certain schema is created out of whatever we are seeing in the world. So schema is something as organized pattern of thought or behavior, which it can be also described as a mental structure of preconceived ideas, a framework representing some aspects of the world. So one has to understand what is that preconceived framework through which this teacher, our teacher, is standing in front of the students. What is his framework? What is the framework of the children who are sitting in front of him? Before they begin transacting the art education system. So what is it? From which premise they are sitting together in that place which is art school? So I think that is the most important aspect we should incorporate within the teaching methodology. Because the primary process of problem solving deals with experience, representation, and understanding. It is the experience, unless and until you are putting in action, you are not going to get knowledge. So on what basis I am saying that what I have done has these values, this particular artwork which I am producing in the class has these values, one has to go through all the three components, and I feel that rarely it happens, even in colleges in towns. So Imarte sir was talking about remote places, so one has to leave them, because initially at least the colleges which has all the facilities and infrastructure, if we can start working on these experiments there, and then formulate certain kind of a subsystem for the regional colleges. That's what I'm proposing. So we have to consider some theories of experiential learning, and Pope's experiential learning cycle is very important, and we can actually directly apply this. This has been applied in school education, but it has not been applied in art education in true sense, which starts from concrete experience, which is something, the experience which you can gain by doing something in the class, and the experience which you already have had in reality in your own life. Then reflective observation, this is missing completely. Straight from this, I jump to abstract conceptualization. I don't make an attempt, even teachers don't make an attempt to reflect on the way they have looked at. I remember in my own college days, that was a tradition that if you ask your portrait faculty or a human figure who is teaching you human figure drawing, I'm not understanding how to draw hand, the teacher used to say, okay, give me your pencil. And he used to demonstrate to us. The demonstration used to be fabulous, you know. Sometimes we are also compelled to do that in our own system sometimes. But I make it a point, before I take the pencil in my hand, if I can show him the hand, if I can reflect on the hand itself before going towards the drawing of the hand, which he is unable to understand. Because ultimately, there are certain kinds of tricks which you are going to show him as an illusion. You are creating an illusion of the way the hand has been placed on the knee. So, firstly, we have to deal with the experience itself. How you are unable to see certain fingers in certain way, and if you are unable to see, this is the anatomy, and you need to understand that anatomy and superimpose that anatomy on the picture which you are seeing of the hand. So sometimes I don't give demonstration at all. I am just discussing with him what is hand, and then the kid tells me after say a week, he tells me, sir, wherever I go now I see hands of people. I can't see anything else. I'm traveling in train, I'm walking on the road, I'm constantly seeing hands. And that's the success. So he will generate his own knowledge based on his own experience. One has to channelize it. One has to motivate the kid to do that. And he will give you fabulous results, and those results are not going to be the way Imarte sir was saying, that they are the replicas of someone else's work. That picture of that particular boy is going to be his own interpretation, his own perception of the thing which he has seen. And then obviously abstract conceptualization, active experimentation. What I'm proposing is that at every stage you can have documentation. Why can't we have documentation of portrait study? The documentation is done only in terms of 100 sketches and then the final product. Why can't documentation be of the way I got a difficulty to see certain thing, got a difficulty to draw certain thing, certain element of that particular object? Why can't the documentation be also marked and evaluated? When we bring in these kind of methodologies, I think we are bound to get certain change, and my experience tells me that there will be a transformation in that particular student. He's about 4 and he has done a lot of work on this. So when I was studying in my master's, I came across these people's work and I used some of their work in order to formulate my own theory. So according to Pope, there are these abilities. So one has to be actively involved in the experience. One should be able to reflect on the experience. One should be analytical. One's conceptualization skill also should be developed. And decision making and problem solving. Where to stop? When to consider that my work is over? You know, these kind of decision making has to be inculcated in the student. So experiential learning requires self-initiative, an intention to learn, and an active phase of learning. So inquiry and questioning, I think, is missing completely from at least art education. It is very much there in design education. That's what I have experienced. So these are some of the questions. You can have your own set of questions at every point of exercise, whatever exercise you're doing. You can formulate, the student himself can formulate questions. What kind of questions I can ask when I am looking at this visual, or when I am having the task to do this particular work? What kind of issues I am going to encounter? If the kid is motivated to do that, I think even you will be ending up teaching him how to become a successful artist. Dewey is another psychologist and theorist who has done pioneering work, and we can refer to his theories also. So he talks about dynamic conception between education and personal experience. And this has nothing to say that, you know, existing system doesn't work in totality. So poor quality and the existing system, he says that it is of poor quality, which miseducates and creates negative impact. So we have seen a glimpse of this through Imatis's presentation. So Dewey talks about high quality learning experience, which will be teaching approaches which promote experimentation, sensitivity, and inquisitiveness. I should be able to want to know something more about a certain thing in life. If already I know, because I've seen it in the internet, I will not grow. So this leads pupils making connections with further experiences, ensuring growth principle that he calls the experiential continuum. It should continue. You should be able to relate whatever you seen earlier in a fresh and new experience. And it should grow. It should not become like, now I know how to draw this. Now I will forever draw it in like that one. I will not change my approach to draw a certain thing or paint certain thing in certain way. So that will not work. Rather, this continuing work will work. And for that, maintaining daily diary in each subject, or a single diary for all the subjects that can be decided by individually, and that will help for the kid to know how he is progressing as far as his perception growth, as his experience growth, rather than just merely seeing his technical growth. So I'm calling it meditative experiential technology, which leads to perceptual consciousness. Why meditative? Because of the clutter of today. Because when I see today's students, they need peace of mind first, and then they can be imparted certain knowledge. Especially today's generation and today's generations of teachers also need this meditative technology, because one should be able to silence our mind first. So when I do these exercises in my own classroom, that we do some kind of a meditation. It could be visual meditation, it could be music meditation, it could be simple meditation to listen to sounds, sound meditation. And these all meditations are available on a click. You just click, and there are so many people who have given you these kind of ready, even you have applications also today. So conducting simple exercises and then leading them towards certain analytical ability, I think is going to help in this methodology. So basically, Jitu Krishnamurti, although his theories cannot be practically applied, but he always remains as a canvas, blank canvas, where whatever things, whatever area of life, whatever area of particular specialized field like psychology, neurology, technology can be brought together on that canvas, as a new linkage can be formed. So according to me, why Krishnamurti? Because Krishnamurti is such a, he talks about such a pure thought which is required for today's educators. That's what I feel. Because he doesn't talk of applied philosophy. He never talks about that. And some of his thoughts are very difficult to digest also, you know. But certain things which he mentions, certain sentences can be picked and can be discussed in the class in order to make each one of the class, each individual of the class, including teacher, and some difference will definitely be achieved. Because we have to have this base of silence, and then, so I'm not talking about, it's very practical. It's not about bringing philosophy in the class and being non-practical about anything. So it's very practical, and I've started experimenting on that and started getting results as far as my areas of studies are concerned. These are the references. Thank you so much.
No, I think I will only initiate the questioning and leave it to audience. If according to our general experience, if our audience doesn't ask questions, then I will come during my questioning again. You know, a lot has been said today on one level because of observations regarding existing systems. But before I go into detail about that, I just wanted to ask you one question. So that everybody saw your photographs. And it feels, I know that you have not done that, but I just wanted to confirm that you have not chosen the areas of art schools which appeared as if, you know, redundant objects were kept there or something like that. म्हणजे तुम्ही मुद्दाम अडगळीच्या जागांचे तो फोटो नाही ना काढले
नाही त्यात दोन्ही गोष्टी आहेत म्हणजे की एकंदर आर्ट स्कूलचं जे इन्फ्रास्ट्रक्चर आहे आणि आर्ट स्कूल आपल्यासमोर जे 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 स्कूल ऑफ आर्ट आहेत ते जरा थोडं प्रोत्साहित करणार आहे पण बाकीच्या ठिकाणी आर्ट स्कूल म्हणून जे असतं त्यात कशी व्यवस्था असते हा पण एक भाग होता म्हणून काही काही ठिकाणी असे पडदे आहेत काही काही ठिकाणी अशा अडगळीच्या गोष्टी आहेत की इथे राहून देखील आर्ट स्टुडंटना काही सुचू शकतं का की त्यांना फक्त एन्व्हायरमेंटच पाहिजे हा एक त्याचा भाग आहे आणि आता डॉक्युमेंटेशन हा त्याच्यातला एक भाग असं की आर्ट स्कूल कसं कसे असतात म्हणजे आपल्याकडे आर्ट स्कूल खूप प्रकारचे आहेत त्याचं वेगळं डॉक्युमेंटेशन केलं तो एक वेगळा भाग पण हे थोडंसं आपण काय म्हणतो की जाणून बुजून किंवा थोडंसं जस्ट मला फोटोग्राफ करायचं
कारण वाईल लिसनिंग टू व्हॉट इमार्क सर वॉज टॉकिंग अबाउट वन क्वेश्चन कम्स टू अवर माइंड इज दॅट वेन वी आर गोइंग टू यू नो विजिटिंग डिफरंट आर्ट स्कूल्स अँड कलेक्टिंग डेटा देर इज अ मॉडेल इन अवर माइंड अबाउट वॉट आर्ट स्कूल शुड बी यू नो what kind of infrastructure it should have or what kind of teachers should be there or how the classroom should be appear and how everything has to operate in a certain way etc. Because that is what we are checking or comparing and we are feeling that something is not there. I mean, I'm just trying to project a kind of a different perspective of looking at the entire data collection project from a premise that suppose if I because you know I'm listening to Nitin and wonderfully he has explained the you know meditative experiential technology I call it technology I think it's fine you know and when we, when I also list, see what Imarte sir has done I feel that there are two ways means one immediate question which comes to my mind is that the educational format which we have adopted in our art schools is not evolved from our own practices as such we have adopted the practice Britishers told us how it should be and we are just following it. People go to say so many countries and they talk about how art schools are there and how we should have something similar to that etc etc. So we have this idea of you know that we are still in the process of possibly adoption and not generating ideas on our own that what we need what role of art because you know all of us experience that as soon as art students doesn't earn money from his you know selling his art slowly possibly his you know practice stops so as a person involved in education you know I start questioning that is art only meant for earning money because you know in Bombay you can earn money in various ways so if art practice or art education is not allowing me to sustain my own art practice, not only commercially, but even on a, you know, emotional level, on a thought level, etc. It does not give me mechanism to connect my art practice to so many aspects of my life. What exactly the education has done to me. So from that premise, I'm looking at the entire education scenario, that if we will develop, or if this format would have been evolved on our own, then what it would have been possibly, because then the answers or the perceptions can differ. In the same way, when we look at Nitin's presentation, we see so many theoreticians, and if you look at our own art education practice, we have a certain huge burden of ideas like Guru Shishya Parampara. You know, that is one of the biggest heavyweight idea which we carry. Then another idea, you know, which we still carry, concepts like the subconscious, which is one of the most beloved concept of Indian art since 1947 or so. Generally in art field or in art education field, people don't like, they love psychology because Sigmund Freud is there, but they don't like other aspects of psychology, to be frank. And they don't like neurology. They don't even possibly know about neurology. So how it is possible to look at art practice in a totally new way, or the new theories which are emerging out of design and industrial, education or that kind of a field, how to do that? Because I'm looking at a framework. I think what both of them talked about today is a framework which we are referring to. Framework of art education. On one level, we are saying existing framework doesn't work, and it should be something else rather than what it is. On the other side, Nitin is talking in great detail about what should be the mechanism or what should be the technology of a teacher in a classroom, which will generate certain processes in the mind. And I want to come back to Krishnamurti. In reference to, he is calling him as a canvas, and he referred less to Krishnamurti and more to the other theoreticians. So I want him to talk more about this aspect of why exactly he is calling Krishnamurti as canvas. So I feel a framework, because on another very big burden which we carry is that people said that art cannot be taught. And still they could come to art school. They die to come to art school. So I feel, do we go back to the idea that if the framework, adaptive framework, doesn't work and it should be evolved on our own? That is the first premise I would like to question or explore. And if the answer is yes or no, then I think possibly rest of the answers will follow accordingly, that what should be the medium of instruction, and if we have to have a meditative technology, or we have to have instruction based technology, or what should be the meaning of discipline, because he is talking about 100 sketches, which is a very key word in art schools, that we ask people to produce 100 sketches, and they, even if they have not done, they just borrow from somebody and show it to teacher. So whatever it is, so we are again coming back to the idea of discipline and what exactly is the meaning of discipline. Because I look at visual art education not only from the point of view of visual art practitioner, but I feel that if a Karnataka music education is there, or Hindustani classical music education is there, or dance education is there, even they follow certain disciplines, they have also certain problems or challenges to conquer. But because comparatively their forms or their framework has been evolved in this land itself. And I'm not being nationalist or anything like that. I'm just saying that it has got lesser of foreign influence comparatively. Their nature of education is automatically or naturally introverted the way you want it to be. Correct. And therefore the meaning of discipline and you know, how the flexible framework should be, if it can take the foreign influence or not, etc., etc., or how the methodology of teaching can be evolved, is there, and it changes, because even if it is not individual centric, because you know, if you look at history of art education in Maharashtra, we do not have theories, unfortunately. We have great individual teachers who were supposedly great artists also, and they kept on teaching people. And nobody said, like as Imarte sir was saying, that aesthetics books are not read. But I always wanted to question aestheticians, because they have read English books and wrote, you know, aesthetics in Marathi. They have not written their own aesthetic philosophies as such, referring to or responding to their contemporary challenges or experiences or things like that. So even there, in theories, adaptive framework follows the same way, the way we are doing it in practice. So I just wanted to open, you know, there are two areas I felt are critical, that if the framework, what to do with this adaptive framework, rather than if framework should be adaptive or it should be, you know, evolutionary in nature. And then the second is if, because you know, on one level you are theories about practice of teaching are deriving from so many industry-based ideas, which also deal with, you know, people who are supposedly going to become executives rather than so-called artists as such. So how we can bring those theories into a practice which we want to be introverted in nature and to be a meditative technology. Yeah, I think so. I'm opening for me, I felt these two premises are interesting and important. We can either you can start answering or we can open up the questioning.
No, the way you have elaborated on the entire topic, I think we should start writing collaborative papers on this particular issue, because this is vast, you know. This we have just opened up, you know, this discussion. And to come to one of your point that art cannot be taught, I think we should start continuing. We should continue to say that art cannot be taught, but we should start saying that visual thinking can be taught. Definitely visual thinking can be taught. I cannot teach you how to become a good artist, but if I teach you effectively how visual thinking can be initiated, I think there are so many avenues other than becoming a fine artist and showing my work in the exhibition. Because now today's contemporary culture is evolving at a stage where they need creative people, they need creative thinkers which can give input in anything. Today a creative thinker can give his input in business design. How a business can be created. So obviously this will be too adventurous to say that, you know, one corporate can come in placement in art college. But then what I mean to say is that if we start even tying up with the local craft which is available, the local trade which is available in that particular region, and if we start collaborating with these people, I think we have to give lucrative options for the students, and they should have a clear picture in front of them that what exactly they want to be doing after completing whatever this course, diploma or this course. So we have to have a certain kind of agenda which is always, because currently it is influential. Whatever influence as Indian art has, maybe it is mainly due to the European influence, But whatever it is today, let us not go into this discourse that we have to initiate Indian way of thinking and all that. Whatever we have, how we can consolidate that particular ways of systems, whatever we have, and start consolidating it based on the regional as well as global, because we have to think global, at the same time we have to think local. So, and starting from the crops, starting from the small trades which are available in that particular region will be the best option to initiate this first part, and the meditative technology will follow it. Because if you want to make anything effective, you have to be effective. That whatever delivery you are having in the class has to be effective, that, and that compulsion is there in design education, that by the end of this particular course, I have to make this person a good thinker. So when you have that kind of compulsion, automatically things will start working on its own. That's what I think.
Okay. No, but you know, means I understand, because this question I confront every June or July when parents come and ask that, what will my child do at the end of the education? But you know, the way you are presenting your technology or methodology, don't you think that it, you know, because art is thought about with so much of emotions and mysticism and, you know, a sense of romance, and you are cutting all that and you are saying that art is not all these things. So all these ideas which are being followed in Indian education since say 1947 onward, say I will not go before that, you are saying that we should end up, you know, stop doing all that, and you are saying that now art is thinking. Is it means, because I feel this idea is
scary,
dangerous. Many people may not like it, because people want to think about art as a very, you know, bhav, vibhor, hona, and all that kind of thing. And all that, you are cutting it down. So how it is going to work? Because, I also wanted to connect this to the scenario where today's, you know, art school students, in their final year, they get connected to galleries and they start showing their work, etc., etc. And market force has started, you know, penetrating this educational framework for last say 10 years or so very aggressively. And it is not necessarily, you know, controlled by any theory, market force. So how the sustainability of any ideas like this will become a reality? That is my concern on one level.
Obviously, if I have given one presentation, the things are not going to change. So what I am presenting is that we have to start thinking towards change in any ways. Because today I am giving a presentation, tomorrow somebody else can have some different ideas. What I mean to say is that you have to have certain stand when you are establishing an art education institute. You have to have a stand that what is going to be your institute making, how you are going to empower your students by the end of the 4 years. Now, whether that empowerment comes through giving them lucrative jobs or giving them good galleries, that is up to you, how you want to initiate your own business. But as far as whatever I presented today has nothing to do with all this, it's about what will happen in the classroom. Today, in my premise, where students are going to go into design industry and work, I am doing it over there. When there is a compulsion for the student not to think in this way when he or she is going to go to the industry. So I am implementing that in a very, it's very absurd that such kind of methodology I am using in the design college, where they are not going to become an artist. But some of them, by the end of that course, they choose to be an artist. Some of them, I know some of my students, they have become artists, because this way of education has opened their mind to an extent that they are willing to choose their own career the way they want to. It's not necessary that they will go and do any corporate job. So why can't this opportunity be opened up to art students? So it's still debatable whether we should go ahead like that or no. But whatever systems we have, can we start rethinking about them? And one of the important points is that don't teach them how to make art. Teach them how to be clear in their thought process. Art is going to eventually come. Because they are, if they are creative, they are bound to create art. But why to initiate your entire methodology in order to create art, and that creates a lot of confusion. Because all external ideas are brought inside the classroom. Rather than nurturing certain interesting ideas in the classroom and present those ideas to the outside world. Outside world is waiting to take these new ideas. Why can't you take that stand that we will be creating this idea for this Western region and our school will cater to Western region, and we don't have anything to do with your whatever practices which you are following in towns, bigger cities. Why can't anybody take that stand? So it should be very versatile. I'm not proposing any one particular model, but a key model can be proposed, and that model can be adopted by various different art schools depending upon their own needs.
I wanted to come back to the point of you referred to craft in your answer.
Yes.
I think I missed out, or Imarte sir did not elaborate. Tumhi te Rajasthanchan jo anubhav ahe tumcha, ki te mhatat ki te amcha miniature painting cha kay honar, tar te jara mala asa vatte ki sarvapre
nahi, actually Rajasthan madhe kya miniature shaili ahe ani pratyek kutlyahi abhyaskramat हे मिनिएचर शैली नाही. तर मला तिथल्या शिक्षकांनी विचारलं, तुम्ही कॉन्टेम्पररी आर्ट करताय, ठीक आहे, पण आमच्या मिनिएचर शैलीचं काय? मुख्य म्हणजे गोष्ट अशी आहे की मिनिएचर शैली ही कुठली पण, म्हणजे जर समजा तिकडे लोकल शैली असली कुठल्याही, म्हणजे आता राजपूत आहे, मेवाडची आहे, बुंदी आहे, कोट आहे, तर ती विद्यार्थ्यांना शिकवणं आणि त्यातून काही निष्पन्न होतं का वेगळं कॉन्टेम्पररीमध्ये, हा हे पाहायला जायला पाहिजे, ते विसरून चालत नाही. हा एक महत्त्वाचा भाग आहे. कारण काय होतं की राजस्थानमध्ये मी जेव्हा गेलो तेव्हा एका ठिकाणी नाथद्वारला ते पारंपरिक कामं करत होते. ते काहीतरी गेला एका कोणाचा तरी लाकडाच्या मूर्ती वगैरे करण्याचा बिझनेस होता. तुम्हाला नाथद्वारला त्या टेम्पलपाशी घेऊन गेलं, तर मी म्हटलं तुम्हारे यहाँ तो तुम्हाला धंदा चलता है, तुम्ही इधर सीखने के लिए क्यों आते? वो बोले हमें मॉडर्न सीखना है सर. सो त्यांच्या मॉडर्नच्या ज्या कल्पना आहेत या, आणि अशा सगळीकडे की त्यांना असं वाटतं की आमची मिनिएचर शैली आहे, तर ती शैली का असू नये किंवा त्याच्याबद्दल तुम्ही का काम नाही करत असा आहे.
सो हाऊ टू अडॉप्ट,
म्हणजे मला त्याच्यामध्ये सांगावं असं वाटतं की असं गरज नाही आहे की तुम्ही त्यांच्याबरोबर जे काम कराल ते परत ट्रॅडिशनकडे घेऊन जाणारं काम असेल, परत जुनं करा असं अजिबात त्याच्यात ह्या नवीन मॉडेलमध्ये असं नाही आहे. तुम्ही त्यांची जी काही स्किल लेवल आहे, त्यांचं जे काही कॅरेक्टर आहे सध्याचं आणि जुनं कॅरेक्टर याला ताडून बघितलं आणि त्याच्यातले ओरिजिनल भाग किती राहिले आहेत, त्याच्या बेसिसवरती तुम्ही कंटेम्पररायझेशन त्याचं करू शकता.
हो, पण ते केलं पाहिजे
म्हणजे असा विचार जर
गोष्ट अशी केला की स्कल्पेचका स्कूलमध्ये, म्हणजे राजस्थान स्कूल ऑफ आर्टमध्ये, तिकडे राजस्थानमध्ये सगळं मार्बलच्या मूर्त्या वगैरे करतात आणि त्या ट्रॅडिशनमधून तिथे लोक शिल्पकला शिकायला येतात. आता त्या स्कूलमध्ये त्यांना कॉन्सेप्च्युअल वगैरे सगळ्या गोष्टी घेऊन सगळे विविध प्रकारचे शिल्प शिकवतात, पण तिकडची तक्रार काय असते त्या, म्हणजे जो शिक्षक आहे कल्पनेची, म्हणजे हे सगळं इथे करतात आणि पुन्हा आपल्या घरी गेल्यावर त्यांचा जो व्यवसाय असतो तेच करतात, त्यामुळे इथून आर्टिस्ट होत नाही. म्हणजे काहीतरी क्रिएटिव्ह करायचं जो भाग असतो, आता क्रिएटिव्ह वगैरे सोडून देत होते, पण जे काही करायची त्यांची इच्छा असते ते काही होऊ शकत नाही, कारण त्यांना पैसा त्याच्यात मिळतो, काय करणार.
पण इन दिस केस व्हॉट एक्झॅक्टली यू मीन बाय इंटरप्रिटिंग इट इन कंटेम्पररी सेन्स?
दॅट्स व्हॉट इज हॅपनिंग. व्हेरी
Because if you take the example of Varli art, it is oversubscribed commodity now.
Yes.
Yes. You know, and
you have taken a very bad example. But there are some good examples also that certain crafts have been taken at a very different level altogether. I'm not saying always convert it in for international level only, international market only, but basically this is one of the important avenues for even art schools to think about creating art objects. I'm not saying craft objects, which has utilitarian value, but this is one of the untapped area, I think, where you can capture a big market where people are looking for traditional art pieces which are authentic in nature, and they're willing to give you that kind of price. And today it is happening also. Certain people from cities, designers will go there, they will get it manufactured and they will sell it in the cities. It is happening today. Even the example of new terminal. This example is another little cliched example, but then another example can be given that most of these installation artists have used certain traditional craft. The way it has, there can be a debate on the way they have treated that particular art, whether it should be done in that way or no. This could be a question of another debate. But there are so many avenues like that where artists today can have. I'm not saying, and it was never a case where all the 30 students went and showed their work in the gallery, even 30 years back or 50 years back. How many of them really pursued becoming a fine artist as their career in their future career paths? So because they had no option within the art school, they found that option when they went outside the art school. Why can't today's art school empower them to think the way they want to think, and the profession can emerge simultaneously?
I have questions, but I think I will keep it open for.
आणि त्याच्यातले काही महेंद्रला सुद्धा हरकत नसेल. एक म्हणजे देवरुखचा डिकॅडचा एक्सपिरियन्स, ज्याच्यात क्राफ्टचा भाग होता, तो कसा होता आणि तो कुठेतरी अडला, तो कुठे अडला.
तेच उदाहरण आता नितीनचे म्हणत होता, त्याच्या रेफरन्स मध्ये देवरुख संबंधात मीच उदाहरण देऊन प्रश्न विचारणार होतो, त्याच्यामुळे मी उत्तर देतो. तू प्रश्न.
आणि दुसरा जरा आणखी अवांतर प्रश्न, तो शक्यतो तिघांना. महेंद्र एकदा थोडासा कर्वादून म्हणाला होता की इथे ना आर्टिस्ट असिस्टंट असे कोर्सेस सुरू केले पाहिजे आर्ट स्कूल्स मध्ये. पण म्हणजे खरंच आपण तशा लेवलला आलो आहोत का? आणि म्हणजे
यु नो, म्हणजे मी ऍक्च्युली जे प्रश्न विचारणार होतो नितीनला देवरुखच्या संदर्भात, तर तो मी थोडा इलॅबोरेटली विचारतो, म्हणजे उत्तर कदाचित देईन आणि त्यालाही प्रश्न विचारला जाईल. देवरुख इज अ विलेज नियर संगमेश्वर इन महाराष्ट्र. सो आर्ट स्कूल स्टार्टेड ओवर देअर आय थिंक 10 years बॅक, अँड इट हॅड अ आयडिया सिमिलर टू बाउहाउस, बिकॉज मिस्टर गजानन भागवत हू इनिशिएटेड डिग्री कोर्स इन महाराष्ट्र, ही वॉज अ पार्ट ऑफ यु नो इनिशिएटिंग दॅट आर्ट स्कूल. And another partner over there was he is still there, Mr. V.M. Pitre. He is an industrialist and he wanted to start a school where what Mr. Modi is talking about, skill development, he wanted to do that for his local community as such. And because Mr. Bhagwat went there, it became an art school, because the Bauhaus dream kind of connects art, industry and all that. When I started working over there, we started initiating craft, and of course it is a failed attempt, let me confess that. Idea was that when I started going there, I felt that Indian flora and fauna is not documented. Even I don't know names of it, but they are part of my culture. Say like a simple flower of Parijat, which has a wonderful cultural, you know, notations. But it is never there as a part of any of my textile design, pattern making or jewelry or anything like that. And but I have associations with it on a religious level or mythological level. So is it possible that I create a documentation methodology and create a form which can be applied in the form of pattern, and I introduce it in that reference so that people start looking at their known resource from a totally different, you know, format and respond to a product or a design or a craft piece accordingly. We tried to do that in a certain way. Some of the people today present over here were involved in that. But of course it failed because of, you know, non-understanding of idea conceptually as well as commercial, you know, limitations of it, etc., etc. So what I wanted to ask Nitin in that this reference was that on one level you are suggesting that art schools should not teach producing art object as such.
Yes.
Correct. Yes. And if we say that we respond to the local craft which exists and we try to make a contemporization of it, the pattern of contemporization which is present today is to make some object out of it, you know, which has happened say with Wardia. Yes, I don't like to use that thing example, but it is there. So what I realized is that the response mechanism for the client which understands the aesthetics aspect of it is missing in our society, correct? So in the end, therefore, we are bound or we are somewhere compelled to make objects out of it. So don't you think that if we do that, we are in a way going against our motto that we should not create art objects, and we actually create a thinking methodology, you know, because that is what has happened in Devrukh, that I could not, you know, transfer the thinking methodology, and people said, okay, how many objects to be made, you tell me, in how many days, what will be the cost. I understand all those things are important, but if we could have focused on this aspect, possibly the, you know, the cycle of generating these ideas would have sustained and developed.
Okay, when I say that don't teach them to make art, doesn't mean that I don't want them to produce any tangible forms. They will be producing tangible forms, but not in line with what art industry want them to look at. So art industry is not in, it's like a virtual reality. There's nobody is saying that, you know, this should be done, but certain kind of influences, the way they are carried in the classroom by the teacher and by the student, I'm just objecting onto that. Ultimately, you will be judging some student's work based on the tangible form which he is creating in the class. And what I'm saying is that strategically, you can align that with the needs of the industry. I think, I don't know what was the case of Devrukh, but then I have to really see that case and write a case paper on that and understand where the flaw was. But I think the flaw might have been in aligning it. How do you align it within your education system, and how you make a collaboration with the outside agency?
Yeah.
So there might have been certain misfit in that, and one has to give time, because for the student who is in the first year cannot be producing those products. Definitely he will come to third semester and fourth semester, maybe one person will take up one project in creating just bags or some products which he is passionate for, and he will be creating those products with artistic passion, and that is possible. Why not? So why we have this objection of creating only fine art objects which will be hang on the wall? Why can't certain objects be created which can be used by people? So this is bound to be there, because ultimately he is going to leave the institute and he is going to do the same thing. He is going to find a job which will force him to do that. Why not to make him do that while he is studying in a very appropriate way, rather than forcefully telling him to create a commercial product? So that alignment has to be thought of well.
I have forgotten your second question again.
It was about art education being so devoid of any conceptual thrust and any thrust on thinking methodologies that we are virtually producing artists' assistants.
Yeah, you know, I actually said that because many of the students go to artists and work as assistant. And in between, in Maharashtra, government actually thought that Directorate of Art will be closed down and it will be taken over by MSVD. Okay. And we went there to create new curriculums and all that. And they asked us that in your industry or in your premise, is there anything called assistantship? Okay. And I said, yes, it is there. And if, because the way the education system is, that it tries to cater to everybody. Means if you are, 10th pass, they will give you some certificate program. And if you are 12th class, they will give you a diploma. And if you are higher, slightly, then they will allow you to do degree and all that. So I felt in that case, if you create this kind of a framework, it elevates a person who is only 10th pass because he has a certified program, because it means a lot in other aspects of society, like he may be able to take a loan later and stuff like that. So in that reference, I felt that kind of a facility is required, because people actually do that unofficially. So I will give them a educational framework, so that they can, for example, in our art field, a need is there where who can manage artist shows and all that, starting from framing and invitations and posting and PR and everything. Possibly galleries do it or artists do it, but this kind of agency is required. So according to me, if I can somewhere do that, we should be able to do it.
Basically, I think that is also another good opportunity, because earlier the junior artist used to work with the senior artist as an apprentice, and then he has learned so many things while he was on the job. Whether he is going to learn it in the contemporary way of art making, that can be looked at. So what kind of artists you will choose, the way design students do internships. So we can start internships in this way, but I think this is not a bad idea. So what I mean to say is that we should not be afraid of one fact, that if we start these kind of other avenues, thought of purity, we are going to make art education impure. I think we should leave that now, because the way survival is becoming so difficult in today's time, by the end of the day, everyone wants to make money and sustain his or her own life. This is one of the important reality which art schools also cannot forget in today's time. Way back then, it was a very romantic idea that I will be going and studying only art for the art's sake, and after 5 years, I don't know what I'm going to do. So the way even dance schools or any other, they give you the place to perform. And then if the performance is liked by the audience, they start performing, and that becomes their way to earn. So what I mean to say that even, why can't art schools initiate certain kind of exhibitions on a professional level where their artists are the way design colleges present their students' work in a very professional way. Even that stand is not taken by art schools, that we will be presenting our art students as artists to the art field. Even that stand is not taken very seriously. Only few institutes must be doing that. So what I mean to say is that take some stand and move towards progress in whichever way you can do. And there are so many avenues are available today with you. I'm just wanting to say that. So even that is not a bad idea.
Sure. You know, one thought that came to my mind was that why and when this sensibility change that the artist has to make money? Because the artist creates only for creation. If you look at the great painters, one name comes to my mind, Van Gogh. Van Gogh never sold a single painting in his life.
No, that is because he cannot sell it.
No. See, if he could sell it, then he may not have become the great artist he was. My question is, why should an artist struggle with the concept that I have to sell? Because then he is creating for the market, he is not creating what he wants to create. That is the question.
I think more than this, artist should answer this question more than that.
I just wanted to say that, you know, we are actually contemplating a whole lot of issues into this one talk. And that is, that's why we are going in all directions. One of the things that I wanted to say to Nitin was that actually NID did these experimentations in the 90s. And one of the outfall of what happened then is what you see in the fashion industry. And it was horrible. It was all kinds of exploitation, and that's why I think if NID had taught ethics and right practices, it might have changed. So I think what one needs to teach is actually limitations, ethics, and these are the different things which, at least at the MFA level, one needs to address. And I...
No, please.
It's a tipni on the observation that you had said. When you said ki Maharashtra, the whatever portraiture or whatever was much better than Rajasthan. But that is what came up later because, you know, Maharashtra kudal shaili ahe, but ti kudalat pan disat nahi. Aani aapla thoda far je kai crafts ahe. In performative, in the performative field, aapla ahe kaitari. But in art, as one is defining it, kahits nahi hai. And maybe because we are accustomed to JJ School of Art being our forefather of art, manje aapan ajanta bijanta data aaplyat dhadharatach nahi ho, maybe because of that, the academic portraiture ahe, which we think is right. And probably in Rajasthan you had a problem because their right is the miniature style. So kadachit apula itka right portraiture kiwa right anatomy study apan fakta tya academic study lach mhanto. Karan ki amchyakade je students yetat, and sorry to say this, but Rajasthan madhe students may be sandarbha zala hai tikde for the past 10 years. Kiwa khup sare baherchi loka pan tikadcha art schools madhe shikat ahe. Tyamule the art students at the BA level who come out of Rajasthan are much better than ours from Maharashtra. Mane ya don goshti manacha mhanje podacha
nahi tumhi mhanta de barobar. ही पोर्ट्रेट आपण अकॅडमिक शैलीने पाहतो आणि आपल्यावर त्याचा इम्पॅक्ट आहे आणि साधारणच म्हणजे सहज असं आहे की आपण जेव्हा दुसऱ्या प्रदेशात जातो तेव्हा आपल्या मनात काही प्रतिमा असतात त्या प्रतिमेच्या अनुसरून याचा अर्थ मी राजस्थानमध्ये नाही असं म्हटलं नाही पण राजस्थानच्या जेव्हा मी काही स्कूलमध्ये गेलो तेव्हा मिनिएचर शैली जी आहे त्या मिनिएचर शैलीचा प्रभाव पण कुठे दिसत नाही जे काही दिसतं ते हॉबी पेंटरसारखं दिसतं. आता हे सार्वत्रिक लागू नाही, त्यातले काही चार पाच स्टुडंट असतात की जे चांगले असतात, पण एकंदर जे चित्र दिसतं ते मला असं दिसलं. याचा अर्थ मी जे ये स्कूल ऑफ आर्ट किंवा आपली जी पोर्ट्रेट परंपरा ह्या मी काय फारसा उचलून करतो असं नाही आहे. कारण मला माहीत आहे गेले कित्येक वर्ष म्हणजे जवळजवळ 1880 पासून ते हेच करत आहे. त्यामुळे आता त्यात चेंज करणं आवश्यक आहे. आणि मुख्य म्हणजे असं की त्याच्या कॉन्सेप्ट बदलायला पाहिजेत असं मला वाटतं. त्यामुळे मी राजस्थान याच्याशी अशी कम्पेअर करत नाही.
I don't want to neglect your question. You have asked a very right kind of question that, you know, art doesn't depend on making money. Completely
should not.
It doesn't. It is a universal fact. Okay. But when you are dealing with a kid who is standing in front of you, looking at his aspirations, his dreams, his wishes, one has to be adaptive as a teacher or as an institution. So one cannot deny the fact, although he himself says that he wants to become an artist, passionate artist, but the environment is such a strong which is acting on him so strongly that you cannot deny that fact. And the time has gone now that you also keep saying that no, one day you will become Van Gogh. I don't think that, you know, as a educationist, if I say that, I feel I will be fooling that guy. Because it is reality that everyone will not be able to, everyone has their own abilities, their own limitations, and I can see that reflected in that kid. But I cannot offer him anything different in the setup of the art school other than telling him, okay, you have to become an artist. This is a fallacy of the whole situation, and one has to accept it. I am not saying that I am not charged enough to make him an artist. I am, provided he also comes with the same, and you have to accept one thing, that the student's nature and their entire persona is changing day by day. They are becoming so aware beforehand, sometimes they are that awareness is not moving in the right direction. So a lot of work has to be done in the first 2 years just to remove that clutter from his mind and then start building certain so if you don't have any good material with you to remove that clutter from his mind, then you become a failure as a teacher.
And you know why this thought came in my mind was last week I had gone to NCTA to see a photography exhibition of Symbiosis School of Photography. And this thought came to my mind that what are art schools churning out? They are churning out Xerox machines. And how do we overcome that?
Yeah, but you know, earlier we kind of resisted about artists thinking about selling. But I think without energy exchange is required, you know, in one form or the other. So we cannot deny that, you know. You either say that I want to sell it, or you say, I mean, suppose if Van Gogh would have gone to a psychologist of his times, possibly he would have had a different, application. He would have discovered something new. That potential, that possibility is present today. And I think, because you raised the point about ethics, important point, but you know, unfortunately, I feel it might be my personal opinion, but in art criticism or any curatorial note, it doesn't talk about values, you know. It talks about bigger concepts in a very complex language which people don't understand. But it doesn't refer to any values from which art is emerging. So if, no, means it is just an observation, it might be a wrong observation. But if we have to bring values into a framework of education, it means a lot. And I think Nitin is talking about Krishnamurti being canvas, possibly for that. Then, you know, entire picture will be different.
But if you are talking about relational aesthetics, then you are talking about values.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that is what artists today are doing.
Exactly. No, so what I mean that...
If you are talking about contemporary art, day. without the idea of understanding value, it cannot function.
Yes, what I wanted to point out was that it is not very elaborately discussed in such a way that a student who is learning in college understands that values are also equally important. Something like that.
But I think that's what pedagogy
is.
Yeah, but the point which you mentioned about NID, NID has done that, and there are failures, as you say. But there are some success stories which are there, so there should not be any problem in looking at that as a valid concept. So basically what I mean to say is that that can become one of the options with art schools. Design schools have that as one of the important options today. Art schools might not have that kind of a situation because they will have other avenues open for them. So which can be, so this is one of the important aspects. Other than that, whatever my presentation I was focusing on was completely based on visual thinking, which is primary to any art making practice, whether it is applied or whether it is expressive in nature.
Just a clarification.
Yeah,
what is the NID context again? I'm missing out completely.
National Institute of Design.
What is the context?
Because they had sort of, you know, they had started sending a whole lot of designers who are like urban designers into spaces which were folk or traditional. And then the designers would kind of teach them how to use their craft to make a design object which would then be exported. So, like, and many of the folk objects that we had were utilitarian, and they had a market within the society that they were produced in, which meant that the pricing of those objects was very different. The moment these kind of designers started working with these people, first of all, they were not allowed to sell wood, which meant there was a Dasera Puja, and what is required locally, these guys would not produce. And the prices started becoming really high. So the local market was completely killed. And I mean, you know, so, and finally there were only one or two master craftsmen left. And the rest of them just stopped using that as a trade.
Yeah, but you know, that is a story of most of the craft tragedies which happen with, you know,
and also, I mean, if you look at what has happened at the T2, it's not a great example of collaboration. There is no collaboration, so to say.
Not at all. Not at all. But I make the same thing now. It can be a very cliched example, but then such avenues are also open and people are working in those avenues also. I'm not saying that should be promoted by the art school. But then art school can think about the validity or about the ethics aspects better than any one individual who is working in the industry. So art, when art school will come into play, actually they will have a scope to really come up with a philosophy of their art school, which can decide whether to go for a certain avenue or not.
Yes.
So
I guess what we're talking about is, you know, talking to your student about limitations.
Yes.
I think by the end of the MFA, if a student is not made aware of their own limitations,
correct,
then what is the point of that? And then, if you realize your limitation, then you explore another avenue of application.
So this methodology directs towards that aspect itself, because today we see students have very fancy ideas about themselves, which sometimes they might not, you know, match with the outside world. So basically, this approach, and we are not saying that we are masters to say that, okay, you do this and you do that, but if we empower them itself so that they will be able to find their way out very effectively through. So our job is just to empower them with whatever capacities which they have. I think if we take this approach, I think half of the problems will be solved.
Yeah, and just to take that point ahead,
we've heard a lot of ideas, and you know, this question of ethics is important. And I think basically the question is that, are we going to make artists or are we going to make technicians? Something like that. I think it can be addressed in this way, that there are two levels at which your education has to work. First level is problem solving, which, as you have rightly said, visual thinking, this whole idea as practitioners of visual arts, or you know, you have to inculcate a kind of problem solving attitude. And the second is to make the student aware that he has to discover his own problem. If he wants to be an artist, if he wants to work in industry, if he wants to work as a designer, then the problem is given to him. If he wants to work as an artist, he has to discover his own problem. But the same methodology of problem solving will help him,
yes,
as you rightly said,
yes,
in doing that job. So essentially, I think that's the relationship that an art educational institute should aim at. And as you rightly said, not more than 4 or 5 of each batch are actually going to be artists or whatever.
Right.
But that doesn't matter.
Yeah.
One is a question, the other is a request. The question is to Nitin, actually. I know of Nati Sastra, which is our own aesthetics of performing art and dance and all that. Is there a parallel Indian aesthetic body of work on the visual part of art? Is there?
Shilpa Shastra is there, which
covers
those
sculpture
yes.
And
yes, and
painting both, or
yeah,
only
yeah.
Sculpture.
Yes,
and we are using some of those principles also in some of these courses, which is very, very much required. You know, that talking about all these different shastras, only problem comes when you go to literally apply. If I would have been there in dance, then obviously I was at a better position. But in visual arts, in the contemporary visual arts scenario, there are so many forces acting on you that if some student wants to pursue that, you know, he is discouraged by some of these means. But we have those components in some of these courses, as even fine art has the component of aesthetics.
An observation. Rimarke sir talked about the miniature in Rajasthan. I, for one, I had gone to this Tata Lip Fest in NCBA. There, I had to learn from a foreigner who studied the aesthetics of miniature, that in a single frame in miniature, and probably it is the only art form, at least I have not seen any other, where there are two parallel universes existing in one frame. And to Arjun, it was actually from Mahabharata. Arjun, what he did the previous night, and Arjun, what he is doing currently, is both in the same frame. It was a mind-opening thing for me. I have not seen it in any painting. So suppose somebody actually does a study of these kind of things that happen, go really deep, we can probably come out with things which we have built, I mean, done ourselves. You know, so maybe we need to really go deep into what we have done. The other question is, I find here there is a filmmaker, a photographer, two applied artists, Samir Kulavur, the designer, and fashion. Can we talk about a collaboration between disciplines and seriously start doing it, which would actually enrich each other?
Yeah, actually, you know, idea of organizing this dialogue was that me, Nitin, Imarde sir, Nikhil, we have never come together and discussed in front of the audience what exactly we feel and what we are doing and all. So we want to take this dialogue further in a more meaningful way, not only to have this. But because I think everybody knows in their own field what it, you know, the similar situation prevails more or less in education, etc. and means the kind of a sensitivity which we are talking about is not there. Like if what Sharmila was saying, policymaker will say, okay, you are talking about that art education should not be urban centric and it should be non-urban centric, and then that will be the end of it. So solution has to come out of this dialogue, because methodology is going to be very, very critical. And somewhere I think the focus or our approach to look at art and art education has been extroverted. We are constantly looking at outside, and after the invention of and access to internet, it has become endless now. And somewhere it has to be introverted as well now. So we also want to have more of these dialogues, but even your response is required.
I shall consider this question to be the last, imposing myself on you. A couple of observations and a question. I second with Sharmila saying that it's quite a complicated thing or idea to address, that there are so many nuances, and as well as addressing pragmatically and practically are two different things we are trying to attempt. And suddenly we are not, it's one talk or one discussion or a couple of discussions or a series of them won't make much difference unless we execute them through pedagogy. One observation I would like to say about what when Imara sir said about portraiture. Unfortunately, we don't understand the idea of the word itself to portray, or the verbs, we don't actually understand language in terms of verbs to portray, to draw, and they are not drawings or portraitures. So with my experience of visiting Bid, Kailas Kalamadali in Bid, I asked the students, okay, have you visited Ajanta? And say, oh wow, we have all of them. And so I asked them, so what are naked women doing in a kind of pious religious context? They were baffled. Like they didn't have any answer, because they are not looking at as, they are just looking it through the kind of reverence. There is no sense of, okay, it's a portraiture of a human being over there. Of course, there are canonical iconographical references to it, and it's not just about looking at it as a naked or nudity over there. This was one observation. One question, last question to Nitin sir, is that I travel like daily, I travel about 100 kilometers in the Tukul train, and I see many people using head cell phones. I have observed that in other cities, people use less smartphones, but Mumbaikars are very fond of them. Even their salaries are about 10,000, but they will have a phone of 15,000. And everybody is hooked onto their phones immediately when they get onto the trains. So my question is, it is so savvy. Like the technology has integrated so much of visual thinking. I have seen people drawing or playing games through drawing and making so many good observations, and people have the kind of films they are seeing, though piracy, whatever we say about ethical pirate and piracy, it has enabled people to elate their standard of what they are watching. Like the film, something like The Reader, I saw somebody watching The Reader on a cell phone in a train. It's such a brilliant thing. So how would you reflect upon this kind of integration and kind of not thinking of a secluded set of our people who are supposed, allegedly termed as creative, and semiotics, anthropology, all sort of like human, the ontology, all these sciences have worked more than any art, like the mainstream art field ever could do. And the art field never acknowledges this, that all these thoughts and ideas have been implemented and explored extensively. So how do you reflect on that?
No, this is a good opportunity, in fact, and that's what I mentioned in my presentation, that we should not object, because the way you are using a pencil, you are using a mobile phone today. Only danger here is that I propagate slow life, I teach them slow life is important. In a day, you should switch off your mobile phone at least for 1 hour, because unless and until you have experience that silence, you won't be able to understand how to use whatever is given to you by your mobile phone. So when I say in this these words, I don't go in the class and say all mobile phones off. No one will be allowed to use your mobile phones in the class. But I make them aware that silence is required. And you have to seclude yourselves for some time, go away from the world, and then you'll realize what exactly how to use this information. Because today's kids don't know how to use what they are doing or what they are getting out of this technology. And this is, I think one can develop a new course also, how to use effectively your mobile phone. No, when we say, when we market it as how to use, then people are going to join that course. If we say how not to use, then people will not join. So we have to be, you know, optimistic. So then we can sell the idea of, you know, silence through that strategy. And that strategy is very much important for today's generation.
Yeah, we would like to conclude the program here. I thank Rachna Sansar for supporting us with this idea and thought of initiating a dialogue for the versatile discussions ahead. The papers read by Nitin sir and Imarthi sir will be available on the blog. So for people to refer, not only in English but also in Marathi as well. And we'll try to upload this. We have a video graph written, possibly we could also interact through YouTube media. I thank Nitin sir, Imarthi sir and Damle sir for being with us and exploring quite crucial ideas here, and for all of you to be here and supporting us through what the kind of journey which we have set on to. Thanks a lot.